Hello, everybody. Welcome to the panel of the category Energy Transition. I would like to present Jose Dario Perea, who will be moderating the panel today. He has a bachelor and master degree in physics from the Universidad del Valle in Cali, Colombia. He has completed doctoral studies in the Friedrich Alexander Universität in Germany in energy and material science engineering, and has postdoctoral studies at the MIT and the University of Toronto. Welcome, Jose Dario.
Thank you for your kind introduction, and thank you for this great opportunity to be with all of you today. I have a great pleasure to introduce three people. It was Mauricio Alvarez from Colombia Intelligence, the other is Anari Molar Torres, Anahi, yes, isn't it? And the last one is Jose Jara. It will be our talk, fantastic talk that we have all. Let's start with the first presentation about the Energy Cooperate Alliance about Colombia Intelligence. Our speaker is Mauricio Alvarez Alvarez. He's a research management in Colombian Intelligence Alliance. And his profile is electronic engineering, a specialist in teleinformatics with more than 25 years of work experience, focuses on planning, directing, and collaborating research and development activities of applicable model for generation, transmission and using networks in the electricity sectors, thus contributing to the profitability and sustainability of important organizations in the sector. The description of the talk: Colombia Inteligente is a strategic alliance formed by companies and entities for the integral and efficient intersection for smart grids to the infrastructure of the Colombian electricity sector, with the purpose of reducing risks and maximizing benefit of the stakeholders, where it seeks to be a strategic intersectoral actor that promote technological development and standardization to obtain reliable, sustainable, and resilient electricity sector. Welcome, Mauricio. You please have 15 minutes. I will let you know when you have 10. And more than grateful that you are here today. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Jose Ariu. I'm going to share the screen. It's okay?
Yes, it's fantastic.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon for everybody. My name is Mauricio Alvarez, like Jose Ariu said. We are going to look for in the first part for what is Colombia Inteligente. The second part, a short resume of about energy transition, and the last part about energy transition in Colombia with some projects that are actually in this moment and in this country. Okay, Colombia Inteligente is an alliance for the transformation of the Colombian electricity sector. Okay, we have the sector has a the sector of the other country has a is like a in parts for example for the president and the ministry of the Minas y Energía, that is the part of the direction and policy. Some entities that the responsible for regulation and execution execution of the political guidance of the presidents. These parts of entities are for surveillance, trade and competition, for planning, for example, with the economic and policy, with the compass, with the education too, with the SENA and other parts of the governance environment, with the Min Defensa, with the cyber security, and Ministry of Telecommunications and the regulation telecommunication with the CRC, the communication in the part of the telecommunication for the regulation part. Another is the radioelectric spectrum for the cellular and for the service with the spectrum in telecommunication part. And in this moment, we are trying to have an opportunity to have some part of the spectrum to send and receive and to use the license with radios for the AIMI, for the advanced measure instrument. And a license with the Minambiente and some climate with the IDEA. Some planning with the regulation with the Comisión de Regulación de Energía and the UBME, that is another part of the planning. We have here in the country an ecosystem in permanent evolution with guilds, for example, with this kind of enterprise or of the sector, okay, in the part of commercial and some part with the exactly with the electric parts, some another parts with the or another entities like research entities and something to have a more impulse the energy and networks like the COSIER and some aggregations that works in the electricity field. With all of these entities and the president and the ministries, so Colombia born at 2010, to integrate all of this kind of enterprise and the government too, and the planning and the cybersecurity and the surveillance. The focus of the Colombia Inteligente is to identify action by discussing the needs of the sector, the develop activities to generate contribution with sectoral vision. For this, we try to have some documents and some strategic documents, collaborative strategic and agreement of goodwills. Carry out articulate works with the state entities, like the ministries and the planning too, and advisory bodies like the entities for that works for private and public entity too. Like this is the line action of Colombia Inteligente. We have like a three focus in active demand, distribution, energy resource, and digital grid, digital network in the electric. And we work in some collaborative working groups, the work group. The first one is active demand with the demand response we are trying to have. And at this moment in Colombia, we don't have some programs of demand response, but we are going to try something about that and to have our recommendations about this topic. We try with this some documents with referencing learning lesson about from outside some several countries and to have some recommendation and documents to strategic fields. The second work group is a AMI integration with advanced measurement. At this moment we really in this moment in the country we don't have the AIMI integration. Some private companies has the service, but it's not a public service yet. The other work group is the dairy integration. The dairy integration is focused on the electricity mobility, distributed generation and storage and microgrids. Some with this to have the all of this distribution energy system together with the theirs. other group is the GTA grid modernization. We have four focus in that group: technological and architecture, digital substations, cyber security, and radioelectric spectrum. And the last one is the intelligent or smart grids with the high voltage application and the spectrum use. There is some kind of the documents that from 2017 to 2020, some kind of the document that we have for each year. For example, for sectorial conference articles and referencing any transformation actions. That is the result of our work. In the second part about energy transition, we have the trilemma with the energy security, the energy equity, and the environment sustainable of energy system. This triangle is shows the how the energy and is going to contribute or to work together with the for the energy transition. And with the energy transition, we have the three Ds of the energy, with the decarbonation, digitalization, and decentralization. The decarbonation is the goal is to go from the fossil source to the renewable energy. Digitalization is to put some digital elements and parts in the electric grid and start to join with the IoT and the technical part parts of the telecommunications to work together between telecommunication and the digital parts of the for example for the facts. And decentralization, it consists in the inclusion of the new renewable energy source. This is all of part of the DERS, of the DER, with wind, solar, and storage, for example.
You have 5 minutes.
Excuse me?
5 minutes.
Okay. The 3Ds with for energy transition is all about is going to do or to have the energy transition as a result. And in this last part, the energy transition in Colombia, we are going to show some 9 projects that the focus is energy transition in Colombia. For example, Colombia Green Hydrogen Plan, this is a new one. This is from the last month. The president signed that in Germany to work together. And another that Colombia awards 11 projects for solar energy generation. There are a very big project of with solar energy generation for the country. The country is trying to have more solar and wind generation. Colombia and Morocco proposed joint work on energy matters to work together too, and to have more energy clean. The other one is a very big park in Colombia with Ecopetrol. Ecopetrol is a very big brand and in Colombia it has the business of the gasoline and the diesel, but is trying to have a more source of cleaner energy too. Another project with the projects of solar plants and another park that is new one in the north part of the country in the Caribbean region with the solar park too in the near to the Canal El Dique. Other projects like the Energy Action in Colombia with 61 companies that I authorized to the action of the energy. That companies is going to start to produce and to put some energy in the electric system in the next year. The other one is another group, the Bogota Energy Group, that is going to have a very big invest in the renewable energy and electric mobility. And another Danish cooperation key to advance offshore wind energy in Colombia with Danish government, and the government of Colombia is going to start to have some kind of solution in offshores. Okay, that's all about our presentation. If you have some question. Thank you very much.
Okay, it was a great talk, by the way. I enjoy it a lot. The question are going to be at the end of that we have all, but by the way, congratulations for your amazing work and for Colombia Inteligente. I didn't know about this. I was surfing today on the internet. That's fine, all the projects and all the collaboration. I also know the projects of Ecopetrol because I work in my material science discovery and renewable energies for solar cells and solar model upscale integration of buildings. And it was fantastic. Thank you. I really, really enjoy. Okay, let's continue for our second presentation of this fantastic topic. It's called Integrated Energy Planning for Cities, Mexico City. Our speaker is Anahi Molar Torres. I want to clarify that she's an alumni of the BAAD at the Technique University of München. Is a doctoral researcher. Profile, she's a researcher as the Chair of Renewable and Sustainable Energy System of the Technique University of Munich, where she focuses on the integrated modeling of the energy system and the assessment of possible pathways for a sustainable union urban future using cities in Latin America and Europe as case of studies. The description of the talk: our world is predominantly urban. Global sustainability depends increasingly on the successful management of current and future urban centers, especially in low to middle income countries where urban growth is projected to be the fastest. A comprehensive understanding of the relationship between the urban dynamics and energy use is necessary for the formulation of effective policies toward energy efficient and sustainable cities. These presentations will show the current research of an integrated energy planning approach that aims at capturing the dynamic and multidimensional characteristics of urban energy system using Mexico City as a case of study. Okay, more than welcome to this talk. I am more than curious also to see, and more than excited about your topic. Please, you have 15 minutes and I will open my camera, my microphone when you have 10. And thank you for being today with us today. We are more than happy to have you here. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Jose Dario, for the introduction. And also thank you for the invitation to participate in this panel. Yes. As Jose Dario said, my name is Anahi Molar Cruz. I am doing my doctoral studies at the Technical University of Munich. And today's presentation concerns part of my doctoral research, where I look at the urban energy systems in an integrated approach, but with some examples for Mexico City and also for Guadalajara in Mexico. So I would like to start my contribution in this panel with a set of pictures of Latin American cities. And these cities, together with other hundreds of urban settlements, host today around 56% of the world's population. So this is around 4 billion persons. And we people that live in cities, we are expecting to take advantage of the different benefits of urban agglomerations, like job opportunities, access to education, affordable housing, access to quality services, social life, entertainment, healthcare, and so on. And as the cities continue to expand, so does the amount of demands and consequently also the demand for energy. Because energy is required for everything, for providing citizens with basic services such as water, or to other functions such as powering homes, transportation networks, traffic control systems, food supply, everything. Therefore, global sustainability depends increasingly on the successful management of current and future cities, particularly in low to middle income countries where urban growth is projected to be the fastest. So you might be familiar with this plot from the United Nations, where they show that the population to 2050 is expected to become even more urban. Today, cities are responsible of around 75% of the primary energy consumption and around 60% of the total CO2 emissions. And with this additional urban people by 2050, which corresponds to around 2.5 billion inhabitants, the energy consumption is expected to increase. And well, these prospects might be affected by the current pandemic, but nevertheless, they give us already an idea of the magnitude of the challenge of future cities. And we also see that the urbanization process is not happening at the same pace all over the world. So if you observe in this plot, which shows the share of urban population for different regions from 1950 to 2050, we see that, for example, North America in blue, Latin America and Europe, they have been urban for at least the past 40 years. And we see Asia here in light green, which is almost, well, which is in these years becoming more urban than rural. And we also see Africa, which is expected to become a fully urban continent in around 2030. And we also see that here in Latin America, well, I'm sure you're all familiar with this rapid and unplanned urbanization that happened in the 60s, 70s, and 80s in Latin America. And this rapidly increasing population came with many challenges and risks that in most cities were not successfully managed. And they translated into urban expansion in slums, lack of jobs, inefficient use of resources, social segregation, water and resource crisis, etc. So we ask today if cities are still expected to absorb even more population in the future, and it seems that we're already in an urban crisis, then how can we manage cities in a more successful way, or how can we plan for a sustainable urban future? And for particular cities, this translates in very specific questions like how much will the city grow? How many new inhabitants are expected? Where will they settle? What are their needs in terms of energy, food, water, housing, jobs, etc.? And also, is the current infrastructure enough? And if not, then what do we need to leave no one behind? And in order to answer these questions, we need to have the adequate planning tools to capture this complexity and to have an idea of how cities might look like in the future. So if we have these tools, they will allow the government to plan for the allocation of the growing population and offer a good quality of life while using the available resources in an efficient way and ultimately shape our cities into sustainable and clean cities. So we see that the energy is a key aspect of this planning, and therefore it should be at the core of the successful management of cities. And well, this energy transition topic is very important because only when we define a strategy and a direction to go, we will be able to transform the city in the rest of the sectors. And Mauricio already gave a really good definition on energy transition, and it is more than just renewable energies as it's sometimes seen. So it should be a social construction process where we look at the different dimensions of the energy system, the territorial, the social, the environmental perspectives, all in an integrated approach. So in my research, I developed tools to model cities taking into account the different dimensions that are directly related to the energy planning. And I propose to look then at cities in a multidimensional way, so that we have a look at the different dimensions alone, but also their interactions. So in the model that I'm working on, we have four different layers. Then each dimension is represented with a layer as seen here in this figure. And we have four layers: urban growth, energy consumption, renewable resources, or local energy supply. And the last layer is the environmental impact. And these four overlay layers represent the city in a specific time step. So this would be the city at specific time T. And if we analyze different time steps, then we can represent the evolution of the city throughout time. And therefore, with these four layers and this tool, we can simulate the energy consumption, the local generation, and the environmental impact of a city, while also taking into account the expected urban growth. So it is a bottom-up model where we have a discrete representation of space and time, and also an explicit in a representation of the interactions between the different layers so that we can explore different scenarios. However, as we are representing everything so detailed, it also requires a lot of input data, and it's also very computational expensive. Nevertheless, it can be adapted based on the available information. And to show the strengths of such a tool, I will show some examples for Mexico City and for Guadalajara, but I will focus on in these two layers, which is urban growth and energy demand. When we focus only on the first layer, this is usually the area of traditional urban planning. So they will have a look at how the city is growing, where is housing needed, and what is required to provide some basic services. But they rarely use other spatial information, and therefore usually urban planning or the traditional urban planning is not very effective and ends up in inefficient solutions or in very particular solutions that work for a very specific part of the city. However, we can improve or we can use additional spatial information also at the urban growth layer, which can give us more information that can later be connected with the other layers. So here, for example, we had a look at the urban growth in Mexico City for 10 years. And what we worked on a paper where we were simulating urban growth, but disaggregated by socioeconomic level. So with this model, we were able to tell which type of socioeconomic group is likely to settle in the different parts of the city. And we validated this model with historic data, and we were able to observe a spatial pattern of segregation where low income groups in orange and red tend to settle in vulnerable areas far from the core of the city, and blue areas, which are...
You have 5 minutes.
Yes.
Okay. Like.
And blue groups, which are the highest socioeconomic groups, they are concentrated in places with good environmental conditions and also close to the city center. So we here just improved or added additional layers to the traditional urban planning and got new information. We got the socioeconomic level, but we are still in the area of urban planning, which is the first layer. So we have a look at the second layer. This layer of energy demand is traditionally the focus of energy planners, which is usually part of the energy transmission and distribution companies. And since they are not directly connected to the urban planners, or in many cases, there is a lack of urban planning, and these companies in charge of, of infrastructure just react to new urban settlements, they usually have no chance to actually plan for how the energy infrastructure is going to look like. However, in a similar way as on in the previous layer, we can use available information to understand what is happening in this layer so that we can identify the drivers of energy demand and the different patterns of energy use. So in this case, for example, we had a look at the electricity consumption and for the different sectors in Mexico City, and we identified that for the residential area, there is the socioeconomic status of the inhabitants in specific areas of the city is related to the energy consumption, or to the amount of energy that they consume, and also to the type of energy that they consume. So when we couple the two layers, the urban growth layer and the energy demand layer, then we increase the amount of relevant information. So this is, for example, for Guadalajara, so it's basically the same. We calculated urban growth, but at the same time, we also calculated the energy demand. And we do that in an iterative process where we let each layer influence the next one. So in this case, for example, the existing infrastructure increases the probability of urbanization. And at the same time, once the cell is urbanized, then it increases the electricity demand, which needs to be covered by some infrastructure. So this figure shows the simulation of a span of 15 years. And I don't want to focus in the details, but I just want to highlight four specific points, which is that integrated modeling is necessary to capture the complexity of cities. If we only focus in one specific layer, then we are not able to see these interactions, that the inclusion of especially explicit urban transformation expands the possibilities for incorporating other dynamic urban processes, that the development of integrated urban planning tools is crucial for the successful management of cities. And I think that the most important take out is that there is satellite imagery and national census data available for most Latin American countries, which can already provide extensive information for deriving such energy models and therefore energy strategies towards sustainable cities. So that is it from my side. If you are interested on the model or on the results, you can contact me and I will be happy to answer any questions. But I think the questions are at the end.
Yes, I am. I enjoy a lot. Thank you for your presentation. I'm quite sure that when you finish your PhD, you are interested to work or by sure the work of Carlo Ratti at MIT. He's also working in urban energy transition and based on machine learning models, or you want to also work with Daniel Kamen at Berkeley in the new similarities also based on machine learning. Just let me know, or with the science innovation project at Stanford University. Just let me know. We are high connected at the moment with the University of Toronto and them. Probably I'm going to move to California for one of these projects. Let me know if you are interested.
Yeah, we'll contact you later.
Yeah, sure. It's fantastic. By the way, I didn't know that you work with Henneke. He was quite a famous professor in Germany. He's made a battery transition of performance energy transition based on new materials. He's a quite famous this guru of Germany professors at TUM. Okay, that congrats, by the way. Okay, let's continue with the last talk of of today. It's a presentation number 3. We are going to introduce to Dr. Jose Lara. He's a DAAD scientific ambassador. At the moment, he's working at his University of Cuenca research group, CNF, Science and Energy. He's going to talk today about energy transition experience in the power sector of Ecuador. His profile, Jose Lara, Dr. Jose Lara, completed his PhD in renewable energy at the ON Universitet. Nowadays, he works for the Electric Corporation of Ecuador, SELECT AP, a senior specialist in energy planning and developing a portfolio of renewable energy projects. In addition, he is a coordinator of the research group Energy Science, CNF, at the University of Azulay, where he also serves as a scientific ambassador of the DAAD in Ecuador. His presentation is going to talk about, in general, Ecuador, one of the smallest countries of South America, has progressed significantly of cleaning its power system through the construction of hydropower plants that provide more than 90% of electricity demand. However, most hydropower plants during the dry season diminish up to the third of the installed capacity, which could lead in the long term to an expansion of expensive thermoelectric power output to cover future electricity demand. However, though an innovative approach that combines spatial analysis, local expert knowledge, and energy modeling, an outstanding potential of complementary renewable energies such as wind, solar, and biomass and phone in Ecuador, which can compensate for hydropower seasonality, and therefore ensuring in the long term and sustainable energy transition. I want to say hello to Jose. I haven't met before us as the other. It's very amazing to have you here, and congrats for all your career and also for your motivation for impulse new research and new chance for continue working in my PhD and master with the DAAD as an ambassador. You have 15 minutes. I will disconnect my microphone at 10 and I will tell you to have 1 minute and that you can continue. Thank you for being here, and it's an amazing to have you. Please, the floor is yours now.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the presentation. Let me share the screen now. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yeah.
Oh, wait a minute. Oh, wait. Yeah. Okay, so my topic will be about renewable resources in the transition of Ecuador's electricity matrix. Just to clarify, my last name is Jara, no? It's always, I mean, it's a confusion with the J, no? It's not Lara. I'm working on Universidad de la Azuay. Just recently, I started some research projects there, but I'm also working on SELECEP, which is a public company in charge of 90% of the electricity generation in the country, but also on the transmission. So SELEC is a in charge also of the planning and also the construction and maintenance of the transmission system. There in SELEC, I'm working on prospecting renewable energy sources. My colleagues are doing the modeling. I'm trying to link, you know, the academia with the electricity sector here in Ecuador. So we are finding very interesting results that I would like to share with you today. But first of all, I would like to start with the climate change, the key message of the last emission gas report. No, nowadays, as you know, the politicians are meeting now in UK now to plan what will be the future for the countries to tackle the climate change. But the key message, it says that we have to triple the effort. So I don't know if it will be possible, but we have to do that. Otherwise, we're having a serious problem. So if COVID just show us that we are vulnerable. Climate change is 10 times that event, no? Based on also the previous presentations, no, it's like energy transition is not only renewable energies, like an integrated modeling, an integral analysis. So we need a structural change to do this energy transition. It's not only putting solar panels in our homes. So we need to change our behavior. This is one of the key messages in the report. No? We need to change how we consume, but not only countries, also the people. And the key sector here is energy. But also the opportunity, it says that if we, of the countries, plan their economic recovery, considering energy transition, green technologies, it will be good for the economy, but also it could cut up up to 25% of the emissions by 2030. So this is our opportunity. And I will show you in Ecuador, we have a lot of resources, and I suppose also in Mexico and Colombia, you have the same. Okay, in Ecuador, what are the numbers? In the 90s, the sector that produced more greenhouse emission was the land use change. But recently, energy sector is the main responsible of greenhouse emissions. So that's why we need to work on that sector to tackle the climate change emissions. No? This is the proposal of Ecuador for Paris Agreement. Ecuador proposed to reduce 10% of our emissions by 2025, doing what is listed in the slide. No? It's like building an hydroelectric power plant, which has been done. I will show you what are the results of that. Then it's also reducing glass flaring in the oil fields, petroleum wells that we have in the Amazon region, which is still ongoing. We don't have yet used that. Install a lot of wind, solar, and biogas energy, which has not been done until yet. Also the cookstoves, using electric cookstoves instead of gas stoves, and efficient public transport. The number five, I mean, we build a metro. The metro in Quito is building, and in Cuenca is the only city with a tram. So I don't know if we have only 4 years to do all these things. I don't know if it will be possible. And Ecuador also said if we will do an energy efficiency plan. We will increase the use of associated glass flaring in the petroleum industry, increase renewable energy blocks, and build geothermal power plants, but also big hydro. We have a big project here in the south of Ecuador, and do the NAMA for freight transport. My message here is, okay, Ecuador should plan the number one. Like if we could do, we will do an energy efficiency. It should be in the first place, but okay, that was the plan. This is Ecuador, the energy system of Ecuador. We are an exporter of energy. Our economy relies on the oil. You will see here is the primary energy is oil mainly. Most of this energy is exported. So that's why we depend a lot on this resource. Renewable energy is the primary energy resources, you know, solar, wind, and biomass is very low. See, we don't have a lot of capacity here. But we also are importing fossil fuels because we don't have enough refineries to do that. So we are exporting the oil, the crude oil, but we are importing fuels. Only half of the fuels that we need for the transport industry, et cetera, we can produce locally. And the sector that consumes most of the energy in Ecuador is transport. But if I don't have the graph here, but if we compare, for example, Ecuador with Colombia, which is we are neighbors and we have almost the similar situation, you have less consumption in transport and more on industry, but Ecuador has very few on energy consumption in the industry sector, only 40%. So the energy in Ecuador is used mainly to move things and people. So this is the key sector for energy transition in Ecuador. Okay, now I will move to the electricity sector. What happened there? In the left hand side, you can see the power generation in 2014. Before we finish our big hydropower plants, half of the energy was produced by hydro and the other half by thermoelectric power plants. And we also import electricity from Colombia mainly, which was around 4%. Nowadays, for example, in 2019, our energy electricity was produced mainly by hydropower plants. Nowadays, we are close to 90%. And we have a small amount of thermoelectric power plants, but not because we don't have enough water. It's more for quality services in the electricity sector in the coast. So this small amount of thermoelectric power plants is more for quality of electricity. And we become an exporter of electricity. So we will say, okay, we solved the energy transition in the electricity sector, but the challenge is how to keep it. This is the challenge. And the challenge in Ecuador is that we have most of our hydropower plants in the Amazon basin. Here in this map, you can see in the green is the Amazon and the blue is the Pacific. Most of our hydropower plants are in the Amazon, and in the right side, you can see the graph of energy production by hydropower plants in the Amazon, which is the blue line, and the green one is the Pacific. We have a very strong dry season from October to March, and both the Amazon and the Pacific basins dry from October to December. We have a high production of the Pacific between January and March, but it's not enough. It's very small, the capacity that we can produce in the Pacific. And this is because our hydropower plants doesn't have big dams. We have the flow hydropower plants. We don't use, we don't storage a lot of water. That's the reason why we have this situation. Okay, despite of that, we have most of the electricity produced by hydropower plants, but what will happen in the future? So here is the projections of electricity demand, which is the black line. In blue is the energy produced by hydropower plant in a baseline case until 2027. And we can see here, you know, these maximums and minimums is the change on hydrology in Ecuador. So in the beginning, we can cover most of the electricity with hydropower plants, but in the time, we start using thermoelectric power plants to cover only 6 months of the year. And if we incorporate big industries that are in the plan of Ecuador, you know, like the petroleum industry, mining is coming into Ecuador with huge demand, electric cars, all these huge demands are incorporated in the systems, then it will be enough, the hydropower plants. We need more energy. So the challenge is to keep this energy transition that we fulfill in the electric sector, but how to do it? We need to do an optimal mix of power generation. We don't need renewable energies like, because the sun, we would put a solar panel here, so we build here a solar energy. No, we need a renewable energy that helps the water. Water is our main source of energy. We need to combine efficiently these energy resources. We also need efficient thermoelectricity, you know, like biomass, geothermal is also another resource that we are researching here in Ecuador. But also hydropower plants should have us incorporate the new vision on like the nexus, water, energy, food, and energy efficiency, of course.
Okay.
I'm close. So here you can see the how the renewable energy change on time. No? So hydro in Ecuador has a huge change in the time along the year. No, wind, despite this intermittent during the day, it doesn't change a lot like water. And sun is also more constant, you can see. And biomass and geothermal are almost constant all the year. So based on that research that has been done in Brazil, for example, by Schmidt, they simulate and they confirm that intermittent renewable energy can contribute to energy security. And Chile, for example, is different than Ecuador and Colombia. You know that they don't have a lot of hydropower like us, but for them it's not, they recommend the non-intermittent renewable energy, but they also have to integrate the intermittent renewable energy. So the key questions, there are many. I will solve the first one only. Is the question that we are working on. How much land do we have to deploy renewable energy in Ecuador? Now we need a lot of energy, but where is the sun? And where is the sun that helps the water, the wind, and biomass? So here you can see a map that we have been working here in Ecuador. These are the areas where most of the, we can deploy a big wind farms with a huge potential to support hydropower plants with high power factors, like more than 0.5. Just to have an idea, in Europe, it's around 0.3. In Latin America, we have very huge power factors, and our potential is more than 10,000 square kilometers. And if we deploy the whole area with wind farms, we will have like 40 gigawatts. So it's a lot. Now I'm coordinating the wind energy development plan. So we are measuring the wind, and we expect in the next few years, we have at least 1 gigawatt of projects ready for investment. Here is the map of solar. Solar is more abundant than wind because sun is everywhere. We have more than 20,000 square kilometers for deploys big solar farms. Here, I'm not calculating the solar roofs. No, it's more only like utility scale. The potential is also huge, is 13 gigabytes. And we need only 4 gigabytes to cover the future demand that I showed you previously. So this is another huge potential. But also using floating PV. For example, here in the picture, you can see we studied how to put solar panels in the dams of our hydropower plants. And we have a huge potential of 200 megawatts in one dam of Ecuador. And if we extrapolate to all the dams that we have in Ecuador, is around 20 gigawatts. Bioenergy is also another energy very interesting in Ecuador. We have, like, you see in the map, the brown areas is where most of the bioenergy resource is located, which is close to the big demand centers, like in the coast. And we have more like 2 times the electricity demand just in bioenergy resources here in Ecuador. We have made a lot of research and analysis of the resource, like cogeneration with biomass is also a very interesting technology that we can implement in Ecuador, which is around 100 megawatts with a power factor of 1, which is more energy than a wind or solar farm, for example. And then with bioenergy, we can promote distributed generation. And hydropower is still, it will be, I think, the main source in Latin America. And still, we have huge potentials. But I think now that we have to move. It's not just building hydropower plants, but we have to move and move to a new vision, you know, like the Nexus. And maybe the mino and micro hydropower seems to be the future for this sector. So, for example, here you can see a micro hydropower plant was done here close to my city. It was made almost everything here in Ecuador. Even the turbine was manufactured here locally, and the environmental impact is minimum. So maybe that's a solution. But I will just finish with this topic about mobility. Now, we have talked about a lot in this event about e-cars, but electric cars, I think, is a solution, but for individual mobility. So how we will solve the traffic with electric cars and the materials, all these problems that still we will have with the electric cars. So then we have to move for the public mobility, you know, like the trams, the electric buses. But I see a challenge here in the technology. I'm not an expert, but maybe it could be some questions that we can discuss later. How we can move the cargo with electric trucks? I don't know if the autonomy is enough. Or just move more intelligently, you know, like people moving bicycles. What in UDA, we have been working a lot in this topic. For example, we did a study with e-bikes, and look the key findings. The energy that consumes one car is the same as 52 e-bikes. You will save, a person here in my city will save between $200 and $700 per year if they move to an electric bicycle. And the time of mobility here in the city will be the same because the car has stuck in the traffic and the bikes can move more faster, no? But the problem, we don't have bicycle infrastructure, security, but also there is a cultural attitude to use bicycle, no? And the last project, we built this motorcycle here in Cuenca, and it was an engineer and manufacturer here locally. The chassis, for example, is one of the most, I would say, complex part in the design of a motorcycle. And it was done by students and engineers here. So I think this is another solution for energy transition. It's not only moving with electric cars or electric motorcycles, but also building industry. And the idea with this project is this, like promoting mobility, but local industry as well. Okay, and finally, with my conclusions, Ecuador has achieved the energy transition, but the challenge is to keep it. How to do it. We have a lot of resources, renewable energy resources, but it has to help the water here in Ecuador. We have a lot of resources, so even we can choose which one. Not like in Germany, for example, where we have to put even solar panels in the roofs, otherwise you need to displace nuclear, carbon, etc. electrification of the transport is a huge question here. How to do it? Because if we everyone is changed to electric cars, then we have a problem for the electric sector. But overall, I will say, I highlight that energy efficiency is first. I will quote Professor Weizsäcker, is a famous professor. He has a very nice book about factor cuatro. And it says that we have to double wealth, but have halving resource use. So use the same with less energy. But also, we have to contribute from ourselves. Now, what are we doing to this energy transition? And not expect from governments to do the things or the industry, but we have to act as well. Okay, thank you.
Okay, voy a switchar a español. Me lo pidieron en el por interno del grupo. Yeah. Ya que todos los que estamos aquí estamos hablando el mismo idioma. Oye, fantástico.
Está bien.
Fantástico. Yeah. Fantástica conferencia. Cuando estaba haciendo mi postdoc en MIT, uno de mis colegas más cercanos era Felipe Oviedo. Él trabaja también en transiciones energéticas. Hicimos un postdoc con Antonio Nacicio, era estudiante de doctorado, y siempre hablábamos de esa idea de hacer sinergia entre la parte de fotovoltaica y pues cómo podía esto suplementar la parte de wind, pues de viento, y la parte también de la hidroeléctrica. Él es de Ecuador. De hecho, creería que a ustedes dos les iría genial conocerse. Tenemos, de hecho, hasta proyectos de inversión social con él y creo que tú, Pinto, o sea, sería increíble conocerlos, que se pudiera hablar pues los tres. Bueno, ahí habían unas preguntas en el chat y otras en, pues así como que me han salido a mí un poquito, ¿no? Yo quería preguntarle primero a Mauricio, que es como mi compatriota aquí inicialmente y el primero que expuso. Yo estuve como surfeando un poco en la página de Economía Inteligente, no la conocía, de hecho me encantaría poder interactuar un poco más con ustedes. Yo vine al país pues regularmente durante mi doctorado y mis dos postdocs, he estado viniendo y fui asesor beta de la misión de sabios, de la parte de energía renovable, de la parte de poco energía con Juan Benavides, y encontraba eso extremadamente challenging, extremadamente forzoso poder implementar algo en Colombia. Entonces mi pregunta va dirigida en ese campo, ya que yo veo que tienen una cantidad impresionante de empresas colaborativas y universidades. ¿Cuáles son los retos y los beneficios de trabajar en este tema pues en Colombia como tal? O sea, el trabajo, la experiencia, las intervenciones financieras, políticas, ¿cómo lo manejan? Porque yo tengo una idea que es dificilísimo hacer algo aquí desde ese punto de vista.
Ok. Bueno, digamos que el trabajo se podría partir, digamos, en dos aspectos. Por un lado, como se vio, como se presentó, pues hay una cantidad de organizaciones, digamos, están las mayores energéticas, digamos, de Colombia, ¿cierto? Y hacen parte de Colombia Inteligente. Es una agrupación realmente. Esto es una organización, no es una empresa. Colombia Inteligente no es una empresa como tal, ¿cierto? Es una organización que es hecha por las mismas empresas. Listo. Okay. A la vez se trabaja también con la parte, digamos, de la regulación. Se trabaja también con la UME, se trabaja también con el ministerio, ¿cierto? Entonces, hay en esos grupos de trabajo colaborativo que se presentaron, entonces hay unos grupos que en los cuales está, digamos, parte del gobierno y están obviamente pues las empresas, ¿cierto? Entonces, ¿hacia dónde se va? ¿Cierto? En la parte, digamos, de tecnología, qué tecnologías hay nuevas, qué están saliendo y eso, se buscan esas tecnologías y se hacen unos lineamientos, unos documentos de los que se entregan, ese tipo de entregables, valga la pena la redundancia, y se le entregan, por ejemplo, al Ministerio de Minas y Energía, ¿cierto? O en el caso, por ejemplo, de las frecuencias, que se está intentando pues, que quede una frecuencia para los AMI, pues se trabaja con el Ministerio de las Tecnologías, pues con el MINTIC.
¿Ustedes, cierto, tienen acceso al Ministerio de Ciencia y Tecnología? Yo ahorita mismo he hecho mi cargo en Colombia, es asesor directo de MinCiencias, que ahorita es el Ministerio de Ciencia y Tecnología, pero yo no lo había escuchado. ¿Ustedes no tienen relación con nosotros directamente?
Con el Ciencia y Tecnología, no.
Porque sería genial. Mira, una de las cosas que se están haciendo en Colombia, que es lo que yo les he tratado de hacer, esto es un panel solar. Es un panel flexible, semitransparente, y mira que es un panel hecho de sistemas orgánicos, que Colombia es riquísimo porque somos ricos en petróleo pesado, y Ecuador, pues ni modo de decirlo, es igual. Y digamos, una de las transiciones que se querían hacer a partir de eso es de tecnología alemana. O sea, yo hago, hice un postdoc en MIT, otro en Toronto, y trabajé un tiempo con NASA. Y les puedo jurar que el mejor país del mundo es Alemania para estudiar. O sea, yo no cambio a Alemania. Y de hecho, me devuelvo a Alemania porque es muy superior en calidad de estudio, en publicación, en lo que quieras. Y entonces también me devuelvo por eso ahora. Pero eso es algo que, digamos, podríamos estar hablando. Colombia podría ser el Building Integration Photovoltaics. Colombia realmente podría ser las ventanas solares con Ecuador. Podríamos venderles, así como hizo Tecnoglass, de generar una empresa que venía de Dortmund, generó la empresa aquí, ahorita Tecnoglass es más grande que la empresa de Dortmund. Y eventualmente eso es algo que podríamos estar discutiendo desde el Ministerio de Ciencia y Tecnología con una colaboración efectivamente de Ecuador. Y México, pues eventualmente, y pues si están interesados, yo estaría muy feliz de poderlos poner en contacto con nuevas tecnologías emergentes en baterías y pues creación de paneles solares. Entonces, fabuloso lo que están haciendo, verdad, me encanta sí. Mucho.
Okay.
Y bueno, y se han superado los retos, los felicitaciones, porque a mí me desesperaba mucho hablar con políticos y yo al final no les decía... A mí me hace ciencia y al final hagamos, cuando esté todo listo, hacémoslo, pero sí. Pero muchas gracias de verdad por tu respuesta. Hay una otra pregunta, está para Anahi. Es un poco más sobre las estrategias importantes para hacer posible una transición más rápida a las fuentes de energía limpia. ¿Tú cómo lo mirarías desde el punto de vista de la parte de simulación y de como lo que uno hace en Machine Learning usualmente es que uno predice como qué va a pasar en un futuro? ¿Tú cómo lo harías? Sí.
Bueno, nosotros hemos abordado esta parte de la integración de energías renovables en ciudades a través de modelos socioeconómicos y a través como de ver a la ciudad como un sistema complejo. Y en este sistema complejo como que se meten varios modelos con los que basados en cómo, bueno, como decías, cómo se ha aportado la población o no solo con las tecnologías renovables, sino puede ser con otros productos, entonces podemos definir qué les mueve, o sea, por qué adoptarían una celda solar, por qué pondrían algo en su casa. Aquí específicamente en Alemania sería, por ejemplo, ¿por qué la gente mejora las condiciones térmicas de su edificio? Que, bueno, aquí se pierde muchísimo calor en invierno por las paredes y ventanas. Y analizamos entonces qué factores necesita una casa para decir, ah, ok, justo ahorita es el momento de invertir en mejorar mi casa. Y trasladamos eso, bueno, ahorita eso es parte de mi investigación, trasladar este modelo de adopción a... paneles solares en ciudades. Y es un poco difícil modelarlo porque pues no existe esa adopción todavía y no nos podemos comparar con con los drivers de la gente, por ejemplo, en Alemania. No vamos a tener las mismas razones. Tal vez algunas son compartidas, pero seguramente hay otros factores que en América Latina serían más importantes para motivar esta adopción.
¿Tú tienes acceso a la información de los paneles solares que usan? ¿Qué tipo de paneles? ¿Es PV normal, perovskita, orgánico, alternativo con dopado de galio arsénico? ¿Tú sabes cuáles paneles
usan? No, tanto detalle no.
Porque una de las cosas que los países latinoamericanos no hacen es que los paneles que se usan, que son de policristalino de grano, no medido, o sea, que es un policristalino más o menos que tiene un recubrimiento de un polímero muy barato y duran 15 años y su eficiencia no es 30 ni 25, es 14%, que son sistemas de dos puntas y no son de cuatro puntas como los alemanes que son 25-30, es que usualmente los paneles que se utilizan son paneles que están hechos para países como Alemania y Estados Unidos, no están hechos para países como Colombia. Entonces, eventualmente, cuando uno mira un sistema de mapa solar y un país que no tiene estaciones, un sistema de un policristalino, un sistema inorgánico no funciona bien después de 35 grados centígrados. Hay una transición no electrónica afectable, o sea, no hay una transición electrohueco. Y eso es lo que ponen en Colombia. Celsia o Ecopetrol acaba de poner una planta gigantesca, pero efectivamente no es tan eficiente porque no las saben poner en lugares... ni traen la tecnología eventualmente para Colombia. Entonces eso es algo que uno debería tener en cuenta también.
Sí, pero justo no, eso sería lo que... Solo de forma breve, eso fue uno de los problemas que identificamos antes para poder identificar estos factores que motivan a la gente a cambiar algo. Hicimos una encuesta en Guadalajara. Guadalajara tiene, yo creo que una temperatura media anual de 28, 30
grados. Sería genial, sí. El orgánico no tiene ese conflicto. El orgánico, si está bien encapsulado, puedes poner desde menos 50 hasta 80. No tiene ese conflicto. Nosotros enviamos al espacio y...
La recomendación que recibimos fue que simplemente se compraba la tecnología de otro lado y la gente no estaba lo suficientemente capacitada para saber dónde ponerlo, cómo ponerlo. Y entonces eso resultaba que estuvieran descontentos con el producto.
Sí, claro, es lo que pasa eventualmente. Yo quiero hacer una pregunta a José Jara. Pues tú tienes la experiencia de haber pasado un doctorado y pues ser embajador del DAD, también de trabajar en la universidad directamente. Y esto, yo quisiera saber, bajo tu experiencia, ¿tú cómo ves la aceleración de la implementación de las energías limpias, el despliegue de la aceleración de las energías limpias en países como Colombia, México, Ecuador, para dos fechas, el 2035 y 2050, con las fechas favoritas de los que trabajan en energía renovable? ¿Y tú cómo ves el incremento en países como el tuyo, o el mío o el de Anaki sobre los posibles empleos y cuáles serían los beneficios que nosotros tendríamos a partir de esto? No sé si es claro. O sea, ¿cómo tú ves el despliegue, digamos, de tu país en energías renovables, en la sinergia de hidroeléctrica, viento, energía, biomasa, nuclear posiblemente? No sé si ustedes lo vean viable. Hay una pregunta de nuclear. Yo personalmente no lo veo muy viable por muchas razones, pero ahorita pues se las voy a hacer. Y eventualmente, ¿tú cómo ves esto futuro que nos beneficia a nosotros? O sea, hacerlo nosotros, traer gente o traer tecnología. ¿Cómo lo ves tú?
Yo soy muy optimista. Yo creo que, y quisiera más bien tomar las láminas de Mauricio, ¿no? Mira, en Colombia tiene gigavatios ya en solar eólica en pocos años. Sí. Yo creería que Ecuador, también vamos por detrás, y Ecuador también tenemos ese potencial. Y lo que hay que estar preparados. Entonces, yo creo que una experiencia, por ejemplo, Chile. Chile tiene muchísima renovable. En cuestión de pocos años incrementaron muchísimo su capacidad. Pero tengo entendido que las cadenas de valor de Chile tienen que importar. O sea, importar los ingenieros, importar las empresas. Entonces, ahí yo creo que nos tenemos que preparar y planificar con tiempo. México también es un país con muchísimo... el tema eólico, por ejemplo, y solar, los precios que han logrado... Si no me equivoco, ahí, Anaí, están alrededor de 2 centavos, 3 centavos los precios. Eso es una locura, lo que pagarías en un país, no sé, europeo, donde no hay mucho sol, que si hay acá. Entonces, yo soy muy optimista y tenemos, yo creo que a favor, el recurso. Acá, de mi experiencia en viento, ¿no? Que es el área que he trabajado más últimamente. Cuando yo volví de Alemania y lo que tú decías, ¿no?
Sí, tengo uno haciendo sinergia, que aquí tiene un panel solar y aquí tiene el coso, entonces sí, me lo hicimos.
Entonces yo trabajé ese tema, llegué de Alemania, chuta, y claro, uno llega con mucha expectativa y te topas contra todo. Hay gente que no cree. Por ejemplo, yo insistí en la medición, no querían gastarse, por ejemplo, al inicio en una torre, decían que no, pero ahí tiene que venir en cambio la motivación de... Ahí sí, lo científico, el científico que uno tiene, ¿no? No, es que hagamos y mostrar con datos, con análisis. La investigación, por ejemplo, de Anaí, que nos mostró, ¿no?, los mapas, eso a un político le interesa conocer. En seis no tienen la información, no es que no quieran hacerlo, no tienen esa información. Y lo que sí tenemos a favor aquí en Latinoamérica son recursos abundantes. Yo en viento, como te digo, encontré un sitio con factores de planta del 60%, eso es una locura. Parques de más de 100 megavatios. Y el tema es que no hemos buscado. Hay. Entonces, yo soy muy optimista. Yo creo que el recurso hay. Nos toca seguir trabajando desde la ciencia, mostrando a los políticos. Ellos se van a convencer porque es un buen negocio y además son réditos políticos. Y miren, un ejemplo es Colombia, es Chile, México, es uno de los líderes, Brasil, o sea, yo creería que sí.
En Ecuador existen iniciativas políticas para aumentar la capacidad de respaldo energético, sí, porque en Colombia está la ley 1715 y la resolución, sí, 30 del 2018, no sé si tú Mauricio, conoces, sí, algo de estas leyes, ¿cierto? En Colombia son, o sea, hay una transición igual con Ecuador, tú las conoces, ¿cierto, Mauricio? La 1715 y la otra, la CREP 030.
La 030 de la CREC, sí, correcto, para tanto, pues, digamos, para la parte de interconexión como para la parte de ir generando, pues, y de entrar en nuevas energías y cómo se interconectan todas estas nuevas energías, todas estas energías limpias al sistema de interconexión nacional. Básicamente, digamos, esa es la regla, pues, la 030 aquí en Colombia, ¿cierto?
Y como, sí, que esa es la de excedentes de créditos de energía, ¿cierto? Y la 1715 es la deducción de renta, depreciación acelerada, exclusión de IVA, estudios, sí.
Sí.
Sí, yo lo sé. Nosotros tratamos de traer a Energon a Colombia, la empresa, la multinacional solar de México, de hecho, que es de Daniel Gómez, y que estuvo en MIT, después que ganó el premium de Certify con Alana Escuro Jusic, solo que este tiene ahorita 30 y Adán tiene como 45, pero son los dos mexicanos que son como súper famosos en MIT, que han ganado este premio. Entonces, sí. Ecuador también debe tener algo. Yo sé que, sí, México sí que lo tiene, porque como tratamos de traer Energon a Colombia, uh-huh, entonces sí que me enteré de cuáles son las deducciones en México y pues como que pude comparar, sí, un poquito.
Bueno, ahora hay una subasta acá. Ahí más bien le promociono al Ecuador. Va a haber una subasta de proyectos, así como Colombia lo hizo ya. Arranca, me parece, este año. Entonces la empresa privada tiene un proyecto. Tú presentas el proyecto y firmas un contrato con el Estado y firmas a largo plazo de 20 a 30 años, depende de la tecnología. Okay. Y tenemos otra regulación que estaría ligado más a la investigación de Anaí, en donde tú pones tu panel solar en la casa y haces el balance neto. Eso también está creciendo mucho acá.
Oh, eso está bastante bien. Ahí hay una pregunta que sí es para Mauricio, porque dice versión Colombia, entonces es para ti. Y ese, alguien que quiere saber el tipo de tecnologías TIC que operan actualmente en formas activas en Ciudad de Colombia y que si hay un caso especial de Cali. Si necesitas apoyo, yo te echo una mano, más o menos.
¿Qué tipo de tecnologías TIC?
Sí.
Pues es que aquí, digamos, pues dependiendo de la tecnología, pues por la parte de la red que estemos hablando. O sea, uh-huh, en general, digamos que lo que está mandando la parada acá, pues son las redes en telecomunicaciones, las redes MPLS, ¿cierto? Uh-huh. Por la parte, digamos, de confiabilidad y de la latencia y ese jitter que tienen tan bajitos, ¿cierto? Son redes, pues, para manejar altos tráficos y en tiempo real, por un lado, ¿cierto? Y son, pues, súper confiables. Por otro lado, digamos, en la parte, digamos, de la medición inteligente, pues se utilizan, pues, casi que cualquier tipo de tecnología. Básicamente lo que se tiene es cobertura, digamos, de la red de celulares. Pues en las grandes ciudades, en general, pues hay una cobertura full de 4G en cuanto se refiere, pues, al sistema celular. Pero ya cuando se empieza a ir y a volver más rural, hay partes donde básicamente, pues, se tiene 3G en la telefonía, pues, celular, y entonces esa parte ya de datos empieza ahí como a fallar. Aunque digamos que por parte, digamos, también del Ministerio de Mintic, pues está buscando que toda la región tenga cobertura en 4G, todo el país.
Ah, pues está muy bien. Hay una versión de Google, hay un científico que es egresó de la Universidad de Harvard, también es mexicano. De hecho, curiosamente, mis mejores amigos son mexicanos, porque mi jefe, pues, también, y siempre como que hablamos el mismo idioma y esto. Él se llama Benjamín Sánchez y él estuvo en el programa de Colibrí de Google, que es la versión que se tiene para zonas no interconectadas del mundo. Yo sé que el programa lo probaron en Ecuador y es algo como que si tú te vas, por ejemplo, aquí a Malpelo, que no te va a coger nunca una señal de internet, o a Gorgona y te subes una a una montaña, una silla en un bosque, tú puedes con Colibrí conectarte y bajar plataformas como si estuvieras casi no en tiempo real, sino como con un tiempo de dilatación como de 10 minutos, que está bastante bien. Si lo quieren conocer más, yo les mandaría una versión de la plataforma, está increíble. Y creo que con eso podrían conectar. Obviamente no va a ser 3G ni 4G, pero eventualmente es un sistema casi que se conecta satelitalmente a cualquier parte del mundo y está súper increíble. Entonces, sí, yo hay una pregunta que les hacen a todos. De hecho, a mí siempre que yo doy una exposición me la hacen, que es la parte de la energía nuclear. A mí siempre que yo doy una charla, como también doy en la parte pues, de energía solar y pues también con la parte industrial y un poco de también de... O sea, yo soy un enamorado de trabajar pues con jóvenes, así niños y esto, y pues hacemos como voluntariados y cosas así como pues para motivar a continuar carreras STEAM. De hecho, nos acaban de aceptar dos artículos esta semana pasada en STEAM. Entonces, la pregunta es ¿cómo podría Latinoamérica utilizar la energía nuclear en un futuro próximo? ¿Y qué retos supondría? ¿Qué saben ustedes sobre esto? O sea, la hace yo no la hago, ¿sabes? La hace una persona del público. ¿Ustedes qué pensarían?
Pues yo puedo empezar con la perspectiva de México. En México hay una planta nuclear en Laguna Verde, en Veracruz, que fue construida, bueno, es viejísima. Y a pesar de que hay mucha investigación al respecto, pues siempre van a estar las barreras políticas y las barreras que no dependen de la investigación ni de la parte del sector eléctrico. Entonces, bueno, lo que han estado luchando en Laguna Verde es simplemente por seguir viviendo prácticamente. Y unos de los reactores son utilizados exclusivamente para investigación. Hay, si no mal recuerdo, 4 reactores, 2 reactores o 3 reactores se utilizan para producción de electricidad, 1 reactor se utiliza para cosas de investigación. Y se han propuesto varios escenarios energéticos, por lo menos en el PRODESEN, que es el Plan de Desarrollo del Sistema Eléctrico de México, en donde se abre la posibilidad de aumentar el número de reactores a 8, de doblar su capacidad, pero más allá de esa capacidad, que no tengo el número exacto, pero pues un porcentaje muy bajo del consumo eléctrico, más allá de esta capacidad doble que se lograría para el 2050, no se pone en el panorama energético, no, de nuevo, no por falta de recursos ni por falta de investigación, sino que es un tema meramente político.
Sí, me puedo imaginar que es más o menos igual para los otros, para Colombia y para Ecuador. No sé si ustedes quisieran comentar algo más.
Sí, correcto. Aquí también se tiene uno, pero es básicamente investigativo. Y también así viejito.
Sí, yo sí nunca me he metido realmente así como en nuclear como tal, pero sí conocí pues a algunos proyectos y sí creería que ahorita en un futuro sí lo vería viable. Y no digo tan largo, digo por ahí unos 5 años lo vería más viable como tal. Yo quería preguntarles a ustedes, ¿ustedes qué piensan de en la energía renovable, la visión de la energía renovable del futuro? ¿Ustedes creen que necesitan un nuevo tipo de tecnologías o con las que hay sería suficiente?
Pues yo sí creo que se necesita, pues, digamos, lo nuevo en el sentido de que en este momento no hay, y es toda esta parte del hidrógeno verde.
Ajá, exacto.
Yo sí considero que esa es inclusive, yo digo que esa es la energía del futuro, pues mejor dicho. Como lo planteaba ahorita José Jara también en la parte, digamos, de transporte, la parte de carga. Yo creo que esa es la única energía que va a funcionar para este tipo de, pues para los camiones, las tractomulas, este tipo de carga pesada, ¿cierto? Inclusive pues se están haciendo desarrollo, ya por ahí salió un avión pequeño ya con energía, pues con hidrógeno para los barcos, o sea, y eso acaba, pues, digamos, con ese tema de las baterías, pues, que tampoco es que sean las más limpias del mundo después de que se usen. Entonces, sí. Y acaba con ese tema, digamos, del peso que se tiene que transportar. Entonces, esa energía, pues, yo creo que esa es la nueva que se necesita, digamos, estoy convencido de que se tiene que implementar aquí.
¿Tú conoces el proyecto?
Hay un proyecto muy grande que acabó, de las que se presentó ahí también en la ahorita en el PowerPoint, y un proyecto muy grande de empezar a por lo menos a producir y a exportar hidrógeno verde. Ya cuando eso, ya pues ya empezarán a llegar los carros el otro año y a poner surtidorcitos, sí, por ahí de vez en cuando.
Sí, hay un proyecto de la Universidad ICESI de Carlos Álvarez y Carolina Orozco de hidrógeno verde en la parte bioquímica. Nosotros estamos colaborando con ellos ahorita, pero no en la parte de hidrógeno verde, sino de una bacteria para hacer biominería. Tenemos un proyecto con NASA en Virginia y Cucucú en el espacio. Pero el proyecto que ellos tienen en hidrógeno verde está súper chévere, ¿sabes? Deberías, si de pronto quieres contactarlos, a Carlos o a Carolina, me dices, te paso el proyecto, okay. Te paso pues los actos, está súper bonito.
Listo, José Darío, muchas gracias.
Yo ahí en hidrógeno quería adicionar algo más con Mauricio Concuerdo, y bueno, es algo que también se está trabajando, por ejemplo, en SELEC, y a la ecuación yo le aumentaría la exportación de hidrógeno, porque sí. Nuestros países son abundantes, por ejemplo, en hidroeléctrica. Ecuador, de marzo a octubre nos toca abastecer agua, muchísima agua, porque no hay tanta demanda y Colombia está igual con mucha agua en esas épocas, entonces no podemos intercambiarnos de energía, entonces almacenar hidrógeno también es caro. Entonces yo decía, hagamos hidrógeno y mandemos a Alemania, a Japón, a Estados Unidos, como la electricidad es barata, ese puede ser un sector económico importante para nuestros países. Y otro recurso que se está trabajando acá en Ecuador, no sé, Colombia, yo creo que México también debe tener mucho de la geotermia. Son proyectos que toca estudiarles mucho, son de mucho riesgo, como el petróleo, ¿no? Busca los pozos petroleros, pero una vez que encontraste la fuente, son energías constantes, de factores de planta 1, y además no están afectadas por el clima. No dependemos pues de que si llueve, hace sol, es el calor de la tierra. Y yo creo que esa tecnología también es una tecnología de esta región, ¿no?
Sí, muy de por acá, sí, muy, muy cierto. La biomasa también está increíble, ¿sabes? Lo que tú estabas comentando, hacer una sinergia de biomasa. De hecho, aquí en Colombia está Fabián Lobatón, él es de Palmira, y él hizo el doctorado en la Free Alexander University, y él propuso un sistema de transición con algas para hacer biomasa, y es una cosa loquísima, o sea, a mí me encanta. Yo me lo quería llevar para Boston, pero estaba enamorado porque tenía novia aquí y se quiso quedar en Cali, pero yo me lo quería llevar al MIT, al grupo que estábamos, pero ya vamos a ver si lo convenzco de que se vaya un tiempito. Igual si también quieren conocerlo, con mucho gusto. Listo, ya me están pidiendo cerrar, de verdad, yo... Me encantaría verlos también en otro contexto también, que podamos seguir. Mauricio, tú estás aquí en Colombia. Si estás en Cali, yo ahorita voy a estar hasta enero. Si nos podemos ver yo encantado, Anahi, si yo puedo ser o podemos tener un intercambio también colaborativo científico, cuenta conmigo. Si quieres ir a, pues no sé, hacer, tú estás pensando en un postdoc con... Y yo puedo hacer algo por ti, o si tú también. Yo voy a Alemania ahorita en enero a Helmholtz en Nuremberg. Y José, de verdad que me encanta lo que haces. De verdad, ojalá pues podamos tener una sinergia con Colombia, con Colombia Inteligente. Seguro que la parte de análisis y simulación de Anahi nos va a servir muchísimo. Yo soy alguito de Machine Learning, entonces si es mi segundo postdoc, si puedo hacer algo también por ti o por cualquiera de ustedes, con mucho gusto. Me encantaría verlos nuevamente. Si tienen LinkedIn, yo lo único que encontré fue a Mauricio, a Ana no la encontré y ni a José tampoco.
No, entonces, sí tengo, yo voy a actualizar.
A ver.
Sí, yo también entonces, estoy así como Anahi Molar Cruz completo.
Ah, listo, entonces yo los busco en LinkedIn y chévere poder charlar con ustedes también en otra ocasión y que podamos seguir avanzando. Listo, entonces yo pues me despido. Y de verdad que encantado de conocerlos, un placer estar con ustedes hoy. Y bueno, pues danos, lo dejo ahí con Juan Camilo.
Muchas gracias.
Hey. Gracias. Bueno, no, yo solamente quiero dar las gracias a todos. Muchas gracias por todas sus intervenciones. Muchas gracias, José Darío. Y bueno, hasta la próxima.
Muchas gracias. Okay, ¿no? Éxitos a todos.
Okay.
Está muy bien.
Gracias.
Hasta luego.
Hasta luego.